One, two, three.
Hello, welcome to Rock the Cash Bar. I'm Ben Mowbray.
And I'm Diane Gallagher.
Every week we pick one song and do a deep dive into the lyrics and explain the different ways they've been interpreted.
We will also discuss how the song connected to us on a personal level, focusing on all the embarrassing details.
Glad to have you here. Enjoy the show. Hello, Diane. How are you?
Good, Ben. It's thundering outside and I like it.
Is it thundering outside? It's not thundering. We're about 50 or 60 miles apart. It is not thundering near me.
No. I looked on the radar. It's just a little cloud right over me when I'm ready to podcast. It's fine.
Excellent. Summer's over. There is an iconic bridge in Houston over I-10, kind of near where I live. There's t-shirts printed up. There's murals painted over it. Some local tagger writes, "Be someone" across the bridge. And it's a huge, big underchange. So it's become like a real iconic picture. And it changes every now and again, because either they'll take it down or somebody will go up and put up something different. But usually whoever the Be Someone artist is, they always come back and return it to Be Someone. Right now, you know what it says?
Is it remove hate?
No, right now it says no one is ordinary, which is, but that's totally the All Lives Matter version of Be Someone, isn't it? It absolutely. I was driving under it, I was just like, oh, come the fuck on.
Also, I disagree. I live in a place with lots of ordinary people. I guess when you get into it, everybody's got their secrets. Don't judge a book. You know, if you kind of peel back the onion layers of every single person, you're like, secrets in there. But yeah, on the surface, there's a lot of ordinary people.
Yeah, I get it. Everybody's special, but not everybody is up on a bridge spray painting around midnight, 3 or 4 in the morning. I would love to drive by there just to see what the operation is like. I'm thinking about waiting on that bridge. Like, I know I'm 40-year-old white guy, so like, it's clearly I'm going to look like Special Forces or something like that. I'm just throwing all of the taggers. But I want to know the process. I want to know the how it's done.
I do too, because never once has anyone snapped a photo of the guy painting it. And I'm like, how is he so discreet about this?
I would U-turn and come back around and take a picture if I saw him in the middle of the night. Absolutely. Wouldn't matter how drunk I was. I would definitely want to snap that picture.
Especially if I was drunk. What else do I have to do with this?
I am so not daring anymore. Like that's the sort of thing that maybe, okay. That's outside my level of even my height of daring. Yeah. But if I was 24 or 25, I would consider doing that. But now I'm 42. If I was watching him do it, I'd be like, you guys, you should have a safety line. You should definitely tie it off. What kind of shoes are you wearing? You need some stickum on your gloves.
Do you want me to stop traffic for you? I just want this to be safe.
Yeah. I'd be supportive about it. I'd be like a vandalism dad, a vandalism helicopter dad. That's what I would turn into.
Do you remember, and I know we talked about this kind of recently, it was back when I still lived in Montrose, and when Disco Kroger was there, and there was a big high-rise apartment building there, and me and Corbin were at Kroger in the parking lot. It was right before some party we were having, and there was a girl high on drugs standing on one of the pedestals, and we're like, she's gonna jump. And you were there in seconds. Like, I don't know why we called you, but I was like, I feel like I should call Ben. And you were there in seconds. And then we were like, what are we doing? What are we doing? We don't actually want to see her jump, but I wanted to see the person talk her down out of it, you know?
It was a weird moment for me, because when you first called me, I really did want to go see it. And I really did want to go see them jump. And by the time I got there, and obviously like you see like the reality of the situation, then all of a sudden you're just like, I absolutely do not want to see her jump. Like your mood changes. Bravado can be gone in an instant.
No, you're like, oh, look, reality. This is horrific. Please don't jump.
Yeah, nothing fun about this.
Yeah.
That's scary. Like if you're that vandal painting that bridge, first of all, thank you. You're an inspiration. Secondly, if you fall off that thing, you'll be lucky if you only get run over twice.
Oof, it is a high traffic area where people do not drive safely ever on that road, ever.
We are gathered here today to once again instill some wisdom in me that I probably should have had. Like, it's amazing like how many of these episodes we do where I'm just like, oh my God, I had my head way far up my ass. We're doing Cyndi Lauper today. And I don't think about Cyndi Lauper. Like, Cyndi Lauper sings Girls Just Want to Have Fun. She sings Time After Time. And she's very cute. And she lost the 80s sexy pop princess, you know, crash out derby to Madonna handily. Like, and that's all I ever thought about Cyndi Lauper. And I like, why would I? But having done a little bit of research and read a little bit about her life, there are so many surprising details. Like, so much took me by surprise. Her big album came out in 1983, which is a little earlier than I thought, but she's a lot older than I thought she was. If you'd asked me, like, how old is the girl singing Girls Just Want to Have Fun, I would have said 18 or 19.
Oh, wow.
Cyndi Lauper was 30 when she recorded that song.
Yeah.
Like, yeah. A lot older and a lot more accomplished. She had a lot more behind her. I guess it's because my brain is imprisoned in the times that I came up in, where, you know, you have Christina Aguilera's and Britney Spears's and teen pop princesses coming along younger and younger and younger. Mm-hmm. So I guess I just assumed that was always the case. Not so. Like, I figured Cyndi Lauper was 16 or 17 when that song came out, but no, she spent a long, long time working her way up the pop ladder before her big break.
Yeah, it seems like we farm them at a young age now, where back in the days, I think Debbie Harry was in her 30s when she got her start.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it's amazing, because I watched the video for Time After Time, and even though Cyndi Lauper is 30 in that video, she's all baby fat. Like, she, like, part of the reason why I thought she was 16 is because she looks very, very young. Like, it's not just the subject of the video is her kind of living in a trailer with her boyfriend and then running away, which seems like a very, you know, late teen girl,
right,
you know, life story to tell. But nope, we're talking 30-year-old woman. I was amazed.
Yeah, grown woman. I think it's also, she was so, like, punky, and she has, like, the crazy hair and all that stuff. And you just don't think of 30-year-old women doing that.
No. That was definitely, she's a driver of the youth culture. So I read an article. I feel like I need to cite sources, but I read an article that was in Rolling Stone magazine in 1983 or 84. And it was written by Kurt Loder. You remember Kurt Loder?
Oh yeah.
MTV News.
Before he became an MTV VJ?
Before he became like the MTV news anchor, as our friend Mike McCrae famously described him as, like, Dan Rather's pot smoking cool younger brother. He was a writer for Rolling Stone. He's, you know, like, among their more legendary writers. He wasn't like a political writer or a columnist the way like PJ O'Rourke or Hunter S. Thompson was, but he was like sort of on that next level down below Ben Fong Torres and those sort of legendary writers for Rolling Stone. But he had a great, like bombastic, like, only Kurt Loder could write this intro paragraph. It was just so much fun. It was just, he's just describing the scene in a really kind of garish sounding Chinese restaurant where Cyndi Lauper, at the height of her fame, is sort of making her way through, and she's friends with everybody because she really is just like the local girl. Like, she's got Kurt Loder describes her accent as a queen side honk. It is. You listen to interviews with her, and it really is just like she's stepping out of a Scorsese movie. Like, she should be married to Henry Hill or something like that. It's kind of, and it's crazy to think. Like, I know it's almost like Adele when she has that big deep throaty voice, and then you hear her speak in real life, and she's got that Cockney accent.
Yes. What's funny about you can hear it in Cyndi Lauper, some of her songs. You can hear it come through. Do you hear the thunder? Yeah.
God's mad at me for making fun of Cyndi Lauper's accent.
I know, it shook my floor. Real quick, I wish Chris Fairbanks was on this episode, because my favorite story he tells is he was opening for Cyndi Lauper one time as a comedian. Like, remember when they used to do that? Tommy Drake used to open for Cher. Like, that used to be like a really common thing. Maybe it still is in some places, but he ate shit, apparently. He had a bad set. He bombed. And he was so upset about it. And then he went backstage, and during her concert, a bird shat into her open singing mouth. Oh, and he felt vindicated, I think, where I was like, hey, your bombing had nothing to do with her, okay?
She gets off stage and Chris is like, hey, we both ate shit.
Yeah, wow. It's one of my favorite stories. But I love Cyndi, and I feel like because she came out strong with Girls Just Want to Have Fun, people didn't take her serious right away. It wasn't until you got to know her more and hear more of her songs later that her vocals are insane. And I found out the hard way in junior high or high school, back in Astroworld, they used to have that booth where you could go in and record yourself singing a song, and they would give you a cassette tape of your recording. And we just wanted to do something light and easy, so it was like three or four of my friends, and we did Girls Just Want to Have Fun. You do not realize how high she sings, especially the line, "I want to be the one to walk in the sun." It goes so high that our voices cracked so bad that we all just died laughing and could barely finish the song because we were like, this is the worst recording in history.
No one can karaoke that song, and everyone tries.
It's screeching and horrible. She is the only one that can do it.
We play Girls Just Want to Have Fun pretty regularly at the loud bar that I work at. And every time, because it starts off, and not everybody knows what the song is, but I've heard it so many times now that I absolutely do. So as soon as it starts off, I just yell, "Anyone who sings along will be asked to leave." And everybody looks at me like I'm just such a buzzkill. And then they find out what the song is, and the laughter kind of ripples through that. Oh, I get it, what the cranky old man was trying to warn us about. Anyway, so we're gonna do Time After Time, and this is a song that you picked. You have a soft spot for Cyndi Lauper for a particular reason, like why?
You know what's funny is that growing up, I liked her. I never like dove into any of her albums, but as an adult, I started finding her music more and more and started loving it more. Like I Drove All Night. And then it's the covers of Time After Time that sucked me back into it and realized what a great little song it is. Especially we had this Willie Nelson CD that came out where he just did a whole bunch of covers and he covered this song and he did it in a very Willie way, like very sweet, very Willie Nelson. And I was like, this is a really good song. And I
It's a
just,
great song for Willie's golden voice. I'm gonna have
yeah.
to look cover.
Yeah, I think this is gonna be a very cover heavy episode. I wanna play some of my favorite covers of this song, whatever YouTube will allow me to play. And then when we get to our deep cuts, there's some covers there too. So buckle up, a lot of covers in this episode. But yeah, I just felt like you gotta cover Cindy. She's such a staple, and it's a sweet song that so many people have covered, and it's a simple song, and I like it's one of these songs that's super popular that you will find out they just kind of whipped out at the last minute, need a last song for the album, throw it together, and that's always the best ones.
It's the genius one. It's incredible. It really, really is. I've got a long quote from Cyndi Lauper, if you don't mind that I read it to you. But I think it's kind of this is sort of what sort of changed, because I thought of Cyndi Lauper as a pop princess. I thought that she was going to be like bubblegum smacking, like half a cheerleader, that kind of thing. Obviously, I know that she's older now and has lived a full and complete life and everything like that. But here's a quote from her from the early 80s. She's talking about her own mother. She says, "It was literally the pits. She looked like she was killing herself. She always tried to be happy, and it wasn't a conventional thing then for women to be really happy. I think that's the reason why I am the way I am, comes from watching my mother and grandmother and the women in my neighborhood. In a neighborhood, you see the women as teenagers, and then you see them again with grown children, all in the span of you being 5 to 10 years old. You see them take on the same look in their faces as you saw in your mother's, and this is the life of the women, you know."
Wow.
That's the woman who sings "Girls Just Want to Have Fun."
Yeah,
Just
exactly.
so you know who we're talking about and
Yeah.
where that's coming from. Like that totally changed my perspective on Cyndi Lauper and on that song. Like I guess part of the reason why I would yell, "Anybody who sings along would be asked to leave," is because that's me trying to turn my annoyance into having fun. But like when "Girls Just Want to Have Fun" comes on and four girls start singing "Girls Just Want to Have Fun," I don't know why I get so annoyed, but my dude brain just goes off and just like, "Oh, stop it already. Like, we get it."
Bachelorette party vibes.
Yeah. I didn't realize that a song that poppy and that fun is really a balm for a lot of people's incredible pain. It's just like, I think I felt the same way about "Girls Just Want to Have Fun" as I feel about like death metal and really angry, heavy metal. Just like, yeah, I know it's going on in your soul. Keep it over there.
Okay. Don't get it off me. Get it off of me. You don't have to splatter it on me, okay? Yeah, I always like loved the line like I talked about, some boys take a beautiful girl and hide her away from the rest of the world. I want to be the one to walk in the sun, where I was like, fuck yeah. Like it's a great little line. I think it gets buried a little. This song, It's the way like a song is presented to us changes its whole vibe. Like this song, time after time, when they first started arranging it and playing with it, they had like a reggae rhythm and beat. Can you imagine like how that would have been? Like, no, slow it down, make it really deeply personal.
Yeah, give this song a little some chance a chance to breathe. I was
Yeah.
reading about Girls Just Want to Have Fun, and I guess it was written by a man from a man's perspective when it first fell into Cyndi Lauper's lap, and
Right.
she immediately changed it around into the female's hand. Because I guess the song as it was originally written, she didn't have to change too much. Like she rearranged a lot, but I guess just from the changing of the pronouns, it was about a guy who's just singing about these girls who just want to have a lot of fun around him, you
Yeah.
know? Like she's like, well, we don't need the dude character in here at all.
Right. Yeah.
You can go stand over there, sir. So we're gonna do Time After Time, which is a lovely little tune that I think everybody knows. But these are the lyrics to Time After Time by Cyndi Lauper, and these are by Cyndi Lauper. She has Girls Just Want to Have Fun. The songwriting credit goes to whoever that dude was, with a huge big rearrangement from Cyndi Lauper. She does have some. She kind of she's, it's, it seems like she's about 50-50. Like some of them are songwriter songs, and some of the ones that she's written herself. Cyndi Lauper wrote Time After Time. That's a lot of
Well,
words.
with Rob Hyman of the Hooters,
Yes.
it was a little collaboration, but this is the first one she got like people were like, oh, she writes songs too. Okay.
Yeah. She writes the lyrics. I think the Rob Hyman was chiefly musical,
Yeah.
but everybody knows the way it goes. Lying on my bed, I hear the clock tick and think of you. Caught up in circles, confusion is nothing new. Again, just a great introduction. Who hasn't laid in bed being confused and feeling sad? I do it all the time.
I mean, who doesn't? When I think initially, when I would think about this song, it sounded like someone who was about to leave someone. But when I hear this now, it sounds like it starts with a relationship that's already over and she's remembering it. Do you
Yeah.
think that is true?
Yeah, I think she's remembering it. I was kind of surprised because I watched the video and I hadn't seen that since I was a kid. The
Yeah.
video starts with her in bed with her boyfriend. Like I always figured that this is somebody who's alone, but I mean, she's literally like lying. He's asleep. She's lying next to him, and even though he's right there and she can talk to him if she wants, she's just thinking about him because obviously she's thinking about what's gone wrong or what's to come.
Just think about
I
what's
also, sure. I
yeah.
really like the line "caught up in circles" because that kind of feels like how my brain works. Like when I'm trying to get to sleep, I'll be chewing on something and it'll be like it's like a cycle. It's just like I start off however I'm feeling about it, then I'll chew on it, like I'm feeling worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. And then right when it gets to like as bad as I can possibly feel about it, my brain comes up with some kind of solution, like, all right, that's what we're gonna do. And then the cycle starts over again. It's just the downward spiral is constantly going on in my brain.
Same. And she says confusion is nothing new. I think we've all been in these relationships, like say you have a fight and you're both wrong and you're both right. And that's the confusion is nothing new. Like you start from that circle and you're like, well, here's where he did something that I don't like. And then, here's how I feel about that. And then you're like, oh, but there's that part where I fucked up and I understand why he feels this way because I did this. And then you're back to square one again. And you're like, I don't know the solution for this. So confusion, nothing
At
new.
what point in the dial can you find a compromise? Like, there's a flashback, warm nights almost left behind, suitcase of memories, time after. I like suitcase of memories.
Yeah, that's a good visual. And I feel like I almost wish she wasn't so literal in the video because she packs up that little round suitcase and a real suitcase, but I almost wish the video was just her singing and not her replaying this live. But
Videos were new then. They hadn't quite got into like the language of cinema and imagery and all that stuff. Like videos then were quite literal.
pretty literal until you get to like Bonnie the living in a powder keg. What is that?
Oh my God, living in Kettering and giving us sparks. Yes, the vampire love song.
But yeah, that video is like, what? We've already covered that, but yeah. Time
After, sometimes you picture me, I'm
walking too far ahead. You're calling to me, I can't hear what you've said. Then you say it goes wrong, I fall behind. The second hand unwinding.
Sometimes you picture me, I'm walking too far ahead. You're calling to me, I can't hear what you said. Then you say, go slow, I fall behind. The second hand unwinds. So she's off, we're gonna have to break down some poetry here. She's off ahead of her man.
Yeah.
She's walking too far ahead. You're calling to me, I can't hear what you said. She can finally hear him and he says, go slow, and she falls behind. Given that the video is about her running away from her boyfriend, like, is this the story of a guy who's trying to put the shackles on a lady? Like, where are you going, talented one? Get back here.
Yeah, I think so. What I wrote in my notes is she seems to be perpetually in a state of moving on without him, but will fall back to him whenever, if ever he needs her. Like, she's moving on with love. Mm-hmm. But she knows she has to move on, but she loves him. And so if he's like, hold on, I need you, she's like, okay, I'll step back for a second. Like, what do you need?
I'll be here for you. Which is what the absolute classic chorus.
If you love, you can look and you will find me. Time after time. If you fall, I will catch you, I'll be waiting.
If you're lost, you can look and you will find me time after time. If you fall, I will catch you and I will be waiting time after time.
Where you hear her accent when she's like, time after time. It's so sweet.
Somebody get me to Ghostbusters.
Yeah. She's so Annie Potts. Ghostbusters. Yeah, and here's where I wrote my notes. She's moving on with love. She's leaving him, but will emotionally always be there for him. Mm-hmm. And they talked about the writing of this song. Like, she met, what was his name? Rob Hyman of the Hooters. Like, kind of, they didn't really know each other that well when they were writing this. And so he was kind of drawing from a personal breakup, and she was drawing from, like, she was in like a relationship with her manager. And I think there was a breakup happening there. And so, it almost feels very Dolly Parton, I Will Always Love You vibes as well.
Yeah, the two people bonding over their shared breakup.
Yeah.
There's a couple of neat stories that I read about this. She, I don't know how serious she's being or if this is the artist being dramatic and romanticizing themselves, but she said that she was having trouble with the chorus. She didn't know, you know, which words to go where. She had a couple of different lyrical ideas, and she was on the phone with Hyman, who she wrote the song with. And she said she felt a hand on her shoulder. And that's when the words, that's when she started thinking about, like, falling and catching, you know, like this hand that she felt on her shoulder was catching her. So it's like, you fall, I will catch you, I will be waiting time after time. That's where those lyrics came from, out of nowhere. But there was nobody in the room with her, Diane. She doesn't know where that hand came from.
She had a live appearance.
Mm-hmm.
I like it. Yeah, when I was thinking about the lyrics of this, we think about it so, like, the way we think of any song, we think about it as a lover. But I was like, this is a perfect song to dedicate to your kid. You know, yeah. I just think, you know, you think about your kid, eventually they're gonna move on. They're gonna go away. Our friend Craig just dropped his son off at college, and, you know, him and Christine are probably feeling some feelings right now. But and that's the thing, that they have to move on. They have to. That will always be a breakup. Mm-hmm. Your kid is going to move on and become an adult. But, you know, as a parent, this line, like, if you fall, I will catch you. Like, you will always be there for your kid.
Yeah. And that's probably the only relationship where you'll only ever 100% mean that.
Yeah, you know? Exactly.
Everybody else who's like, you fail me enough times, like, you're going to have to pick yourself up this time. And if you can't, maybe I'll have to leave. But
yeah.
With your child, the only time that you won't feel that way.
Yeah. I remember when my first breakup, my first, like, 5-year relationship that we dated through high school and college. And when we broke up, we tried to do it very, like, you know, we're going to be best friends. And I remember him saying, you know, your future boyfriend's going to have to just accept that your ex-boyfriend is your best friend. And that crumbled so fast. No one accepts that.
Yeah, that's absolutely unacceptable. Trying to carry on a friendship like that will always have complications. I've tried to do it twice, and it doesn't work. Like I still have warm feelings with two of my significant exes, but we don't talk very often for exactly that reason. Like it's gonna cause problems, so just don't do it.
Yeah, that line, your future boyfriend will have to accept. And I'm like, buddy, he won't.
Nope. That ain't gonna happen.
Darkness has turned to gray. Watching through windows, you're wondering if I'm okay. Secrets stolen from deep inside. The drum beats out of time.
After my picture fades and darkness has turned to gray, watching through windows, you're wondering if I'm okay. Secrets stolen from deep inside, the drum beats out of time. All right, sorry, I stumbled over that.
No, you got it. I mean, that this is where the song, you know, I understand the poetry up until secrets stolen from deep inside. The drum beat.
Yeah.
Have we lost you know, the clock was moving and now things are a little unorganized, it seems like.
Yeah, or she's obviously looking back. I think that's what when they say like the second hand unwinds, it's just like I'm slowly, it's the second hand moving backwards. So you can slowly look back over a brief period of time, right? I think that's what she's trying to say there poetically, at least with that line. Watching through windows, you're wondering if I'm okay. Yeah, so like obviously she's after my picture fades and darkness has turned to gray. They've been apart for a while. Their memories are starting to fade. Watching through windows, you're wondering if I'm okay. So he's looking from a long way away, hoping that she's all right or wondering if she's all right. Secrets stolen from deep inside. It could easily just be when two people get so close to each other, you learn things about each other, some of them good, some of them bad. And as you come away from a relationship, sometimes you're just like, I better fix that in me so that the next person doesn't find it.
Oh, that's a good one. I just put a question mark on that line because it feels very deeply personal, and I'm like, maybe only she knows what that means, and that's okay.
It could be. And also, like we are talking pop lyrics, it could be that it's just filler.
It rhymes with something.
That'll do. It works. It fits the rhythm, fits the melody. Done.
Don't overthink it, Diane, on a podcast about lyrics.
You're meant, and those are most of the lyrics. I mean, the chorus repeats a couple of times. It says, "You said go slow, I fall behind. The second hand unwinds." So she hits that a second time, emphasizes it, and then it's time after time, eight or nine times after that, and those are the lyrics to time after time.
Time. I mean, I'm exaggerating her accent there, but I love singing it like time after time. Yeah, and I love the story how she got like they knew that they needed a song. And so, I mean, it's crazy like seeing where people get their inspiration from. Like she just saw in the what is the book we all used to have that shows you what's on TV, the TV guide. And there was a movie called Time After Time. It's a 1979 science fiction movie starring Malcolm McDowell as H.G. Wells, whose time machine is stolen by Jack the Ripper, who uses it to travel from 1993 to 1979. That's she just saw the name of that movie in the TV guide and was like, I got a title. I think I have a title. She just liked Time After Time. And then they write this other whole song, and then they say they wrote the chorus last. And so it's just, it blows my mind how brilliant people can throw together. It makes me always like, keep it simple, stupid. The best songs are thrown together like this and in like in a crunch.
It does make me wonder though, because she had there were so many songs in this album that weren't written by her. They were written, for her or written for somebody else that the label had the rights to. And they basically let her pick and choose. But as she's picking and choosing, like she picks Girls Just Want to Have Fun, which is written from the male perspective, and she changes it around into the female perspective, and it really works for her. I wonder if producers and bandmates and other people weren't watching her throughout that whole process and thinking, this lady can write her own songs and she should write her own songs, and we need to give her time and space and confidence to go ahead and do it. Like, I wonder if the record label calling and saying, we got room for one more song or we need one more song, you better come up with one right now. I wonder if that's like hidden motivation, like I don't know, like almost like a carrot and a stick thing. It's like you get in there and you write yourself your own song. You learn how to do it because we believe that you can.
Yep. And yeah, we know you can. And then, oh God, True Colors comes out later. Oh, so good. Mm-hmm. Oh God. Yeah. And they, another thing about the song, he said, we never did a demo of the song. We just kind of bashed it out on the piano over a couple of days, maybe a week or two, and didn't do a demo, went right to the 24 track machine. So what we hear is the demo.
Yeah, that's basically it's the raw early recording. Like, here you go. It's perfect. Don't change a note.
Mm-hmm. A little fun fact I like to say about the video is she rejected the director's suggestion to manually induce a tear because she was confident in her ability to cry whenever she wanted to.
Ooh.
So that's when you go and watch the video. That's a real emotional tear from old Cyndi.
Mm-hmm. She's really acting. She's a method actor.
Yes. Well, she's connected. She, you know, I think it's not hard when you sing a song that comes from a personal story of yours that you're not trying to connect to someone else's lyric. You're like, no, this happened to me. So yes, I can get emotional over this song.
Mm-hmm. Her backstory is kind of eye-opening.
You want to tell me about it?
She's, would you be surprised to learn that she's from Queens, New York?
No, she talks just like the nanny. That's crazy.
She's from New York. Her father was a, he was into like weird kinds of architecture and stuff like that. Mom and dad break up. He's described as an unusual man. Mom and dad break up, and that leaves Cyndi and the kids, or mom and the kids alone. Cyndi obviously has this great big booming voice, but she's also a bit of a rebel, as you might have guessed. Mom's working 16-hour shifts at the diner trying to make ends meet. And so this is what Cindy's growing up with. Mom gets frustrated and sends Cyndi off to a Catholic boarding school. But not like, I mean, we're talking like she's a diner waitress. So it's not like you're going to the Catholic boarding school. You're going to basically the Catholic orphan school. You're going into some real Oliver Twist shit.
Yeah.
One night, Cindy's like 9 years old and she's in bed with her 14-year-old cot mate. And they're giving each other back scratches, back massages, taking care of each other. You know, orphan girls giving one another love. People trying to take care of one another. Young kids giving each other the emotional support they need. A nun sees what they're doing and breaks them up and calls them lesbians and, you know, beats them in the face and everything like that. And just gives them just absolute hell. So needless to say, when she can finally get out of there a couple of years later, that's when she gets out and she starts like the bohemian New York artist sort of thing. You know, she's young and cute. She has this great big voice. So she starts singing in all these different kinds of rock bands and things. At one point, you know, she's meeting these record producers and venue owners and things. She meets somebody who has a cabin or something in the woods north of Toronto, Canada, where she goes up and just sings to herself and learns to write and learns to basically be a bohemian artist. And she makes her way back down the coast again, where she starts at art school, this is where she meets a new group of friends that sort of get her involved in the New York music scene. And that's when things really start to take off for her. She forms a band called Blue Angel, which had kind of they're meant to be like a rhythm and blues sort of, you know, garage rock band that she's singing over top of. And evidently they're pretty good. Like they're getting some local attention. They get a record deal, but all the record company bigwigs that see the band are just like, she's great. The rest of you can fuck off.
Which happens so often.
Yeah, but she wouldn't do it. Like she wouldn't go, like part of the reason why I was like, her big album, her big solo album, She's So Unusual, comes out in 1983. Cyndi Lauper is 30 years old. The reason it took her so long to get to that kind of big mainstream success, it wasn't because it wasn't being offered to her. It was because she was turning it down. Like she's literally saying, I'm not going anywhere without my band. She said it over and over and over again. This band had a manager, a guy named Masarsky, who is also one of the guys that just like, you're great, the band sucks. I'm staying with the band. Okay, fuck it, fine. We'll put something out with the band. They put out this album. It doesn't really, it's not a commercial hit, but you know, music people are just like, oh no, we like it. I'm thinking the same thing. She's great. The band, maybe not so much, but the album's not going anywhere. So this guy, Masarsky, the manager, gets fed up and he sues the whole band for $80,000, you know, whatever he's sunk into it. Basically telling them just like, you're not listening to my advice. I said she's wonderful and the rest of you suck. I've sunk a whole bunch of money into people that suck. I want that money back.
Ooh.
So Cyndi Lauper and several other members of the band declare bankruptcy. You know, they're just like, we don't have $80,000. That album wasn't a hit. Our tours aren't selling out. Like, we're not making any money. We don't have $80,000. They declare for bankruptcy. The whole thing goes in front of a judge. The judge claps the gavel and dismisses it with the classic line, let the canary sing.
Oh, wow. That's
what the judge says. So Cyndi Lauper sort of takes that inspiration and just goes, okay, I will be a solo artist. And then she starts collaborating with producers and other musicians on the album that eventually became She's So Unusual. But there's a documentary coming out very soon called Let the Canary Sing that's all about this period in Cyndi Lauper's life. Like, it's going to, like, I guess from what I read, it's going to deal with basically the two, or what she thinks of as the two main periods of her life, the period between the bankruptcy filing and She's So Unusual coming out. And then sort of the later period of her life as she's become kind of a grand dame, if you will.
Yeah.
With, like you say, with songs like True Colors being a real LGBTQ anthem. She's written songs about a friend of hers that died of AIDS. She's been a real humanitarian for queer causes and for AIDS causes, transgender causes, and obviously female causes. So she sees those as the two really important parts of her life. You know, the part that made her rich and famous, and then allowed her to have this voice to go and affect the causes that mean so much to her.
Yeah, see? And you just thought she had an annoying song that played at your bar.
Yep, that was pretty dumb of me. Life is a slow release from ignorance, and some days you get released a little faster than others. How do you keep learning that lesson over and over again? Like, serious people can make pop music, Ben.
I know.
Music is not an unserious thing, for the love of God.
I know. And you know what's weird is, you know, we call this pop music, and it very much was, but Cyndi looks like a punk rocker. So I was always like, where do I place her? Like, I always wanted to put her in new wave because she looked like it. But I was like, but that's not what her music is. It's not what it sounds like. She's just great. She's just a star.
I think she's kind of her own thing. Like, it's difficult to, like, you kind of think of the solo singer. Like, there's an unbroken line from going like to Dionne Warwick, or going like Aretha Franklin, you know, all the way, you know, down through like Carly Simon into Madonna and Cyndi Lauper, and then on to Britney Spears and Lady Gaga.
Right.
But not really, because like prior to Cyndi Lauper and Madonna, these women were singing pretty traditional love ballads, or they were in Motown. Like the idea of girl pop is a thing that comes around with the advent of MTV. You know, like it comes along when people are just like, we need pretty things in short skirts to get the eyeballs on the TV. And then I think, you know, women, creative women like Madonna and like Cyndi Lauper just saw the opportunity. They're just like, well, you know, if I have to show a little leg to get the message out, then that's what I'll do. You know, right. And both of them take their licks early in their career where they just get dismissed as like, you're just a sex bot. You're just selling sex. You're just selling sex. And it's not until they get older and their hits kind of work their way into our minds where we're finally willing to listen to them when they start saying things like, that's what I had to do to get on the TV.
Right.
You know, it's the message that I wanted to get out. Like, that's what I had to do to send it. Like, don't blame me for it.
Yeah, play the game. I played the game, bitch. So I want to talk about great covers, because there's three covers that have charted in America of this song. One I hate with all my heart, and I don't even want to mention it. I don't even know who they were. The male rock band Quiet Drive included it on their 2007 album, and I listened to it, and it just sounds like every faux alternative 90s band from like late 90s band that I hated that called themselves alternative, but I'm like, you're not, this sucks, Chumbawamba, get out of here. But if you want to listen to the Quiet Drive version, you can do that on your own. I'm not playing it on this podcast. R&B singer, I don't even know how to say this, it's all capital letters, so INOJ put the song to a synthesized beat in 1998 and it went to number 6, and that one's very sweet and very good.
Lying in my bed, hear the clock tick
like clip of that, but one of the biggest ones is the contestant Javier Colon from The Voice. He sang it on The Voice, and then I think they released it, and it's so good. He's so talented. That's a very good version. If you're lost, you can look, and you will find me. Time after time, if you fall, I will catch you. I will be waiting. Time after time. Cyndi Lauper's favorite cover of this is an instrumental cover from jazz great Miles Davis. And it's just purely instrumental, which is really nice.
Of course, that's her favorite. Like how, like Miles Davis redid something.
I know. My favorite, and I wanted so bad to get Corbin's dad to come in to my studio and with his guitar and sing, because Corbin's dad sounds like Willie Nelson when he sings. And Willie Nelson's cover of Time After Time is one of my favorites. I mean, he doesn't have the vocal range of some of these other people I've talked about, but he just does it in his very Willie way. Very, very sweet, very Willie. And I love it so much. Corbin's dad wanted to, but he's like, I have a sinus infection right now. I don't think I can do it. And then he listened to Willie's version. He's like, I think he has a sinus infection when he recorded it. And maybe eventually I can get him to do it. Maybe we'll put it on our Patreon.
Yeah, let's do it. Let's make that a thing to do for sure.
Yeah,
because he's. Oh, I want to hear the Willie version. I'm going to listen to the Willie version as soon as we're finished. I can't believe I didn't look that up. If you're lost, you can look, and you will find me. Time after time, if you fall, I will catch you, and I'll be waiting.
Time after time. Yeah, it's really, I can't believe it didn't chart, but you know, he did this one album of a whole bunch of covers and it's great. One of my favorites, I don't know if it was on that album, but he did a duet with Snoop Dogg and it's called Roll Me Up and Smoke Me When I Die. And Snoop Dogg sings on it. He doesn't rap, he sings, and it's Roll Me Up and Smoke Me When I Die. It's really good. You should check that out. God, I love Willie. Oh God, when Willie goes, what are we gonna do? What are we?
Don't
gonna
talk do? That way. Don't yeah. talk that way.
I'll change the subject. All right, what? Go ahead.
Texas and England are like in a race right now. It's like, is the Queen or Willie? Like, place your bet.
You lost, Queen. Sorry. I want to do, Jeremy's back. So we are going to do 6 degrees of Tinted Windows. And then, like I said, there's more covers coming. I want to get to you and I, we have some good deep cuts. So, but like, let's welcome Jeremy back and together let's watch some 6 degrees of Tinted Windows. He's in a hotel in Portland. I think he pushed this out really fast because he just wanted to be back. So let's watch.
Hey friends, welcome back to the first 6 degrees after our summer vacation, where we'll try to connect Tinted Windows to Cyndi Lauper. Lauper co-wrote a number of songs with Tom Kelly, the songwriter, not the former Minnesota Twins manager, as did a number of 80s artists, including Susanna Hoffs of the Bengals, Chrissy Amphlett of the Divinyls, and the Pretenders' Chrissy Hynde. As we've discussed previously, the Pretenders' One Night in 2018 featured Superchunk's touring rhythm section of Jason Narduzzi and John Worster, and Worster, like every other North Carolina musician of the 90s, did a brief stint in Whiskey Town, as did James Iha, the guitar player from Tinted Windows. So this week we went Cyndi Lauper to Tom Kelly to the Pretenders to John Worster to Tinted Windows. Back to Diane and Ben.
All right. Thank God for Whiskey Town.
The connective tissue across all things. I meant to bring this up earlier. It's just a little Cyndi Lauper tidbit that was also did you know that she's only an Academy Award winner away from being the very rare EGOT?
No.
Oscar and Tony. Yeah. All she needs is an Academy Award. And she can get an Academy Award for songwriting. Oh, Eminem is an Academy Award winner. Phil Collins, Academy Award winner. Elton John, Academy Award winner.
How is this not her goal? She has to get it.
It should be the goal of every filmmaker out there. Like just get
Cyndi on demand. Let's do it. Let's
make this fucking happen.
Cyndi. Like, I want this to happen real bad. Oh, come on, Cyndi. You got it. You got it. Corbin's been on this rampage, and he does this every now and then, where he'll just start at the beginning of 30 Rock and watch it all the way through. And it's top level. It's one of the best shows in the world. The jokes are so good in that. But I just recently saw the one where Tracy Jordan is trying to EGOT, and it's
right, EGOT, yeah. Colin Woods gets so mad at me when I say this, but 30 Rock is pound for pound every bit as quotable as The Simpsons. Like, I understand, like, yes. The Simpsons 78 seasons and so many, many vastly more episodes. So there's just way, way more Simpsons quotes. But pound for pound, episode for episode, 30 Rock is every bit as quotable.
And most of them come from Jack Donaghy. Oh my. And then, you know, I take that back. It's every damn character on that. I mean, that show has some of the best writing I've ever seen in my life. And I have a couple friends who tried to dare say it's not good. And I was like, if you say it's not good, that means you have not watched it. You have not watched it.
I judge you pretty harshly if you tell me that you don't find 30 Rock funny.
It means then you're dumb and it's over your head. I'm sorry I said it out loud. Sorry. It's from someone who loves comedy and loves good comedy writing. That show is so far above anything else. It's mm-hmm. perfect.
I will not be ignored like that time at my sister's funeral.
Is that Jenna? Yes. Of course it is. Fuck, that's so good. All right, so you have a good story, so I'm gonna let you go first, because I've had two deep cuts and you haven't, so I want to hear what your deep cut is.
My deep cut, well, I was getting kind of cutesy. My deep cut today is a song called Time After Time.
Oh shit.
By a little band called from Athens, Georgia, called REM. And I was trying to look for what the connection was, because these songs they come out around the same time. Cyndi Lauper's was a couple of years earlier, but I wanted to see if like there had to be some connection. But on REM's Reckoning, which came out in 1984-85, there's a song called Time After Time, and it's a great REM song from that era. It's like, it's a weird one where they're just sort of like finding their, in the early days they were kind of like a weird like rhythmic dance band, you know, like they had, you know, pretty obviously queer Michael Stipe skipping around on stage. And then they had this great rhythm section that was very danceable. So the early REM shows were just like, I have never seen people move like this. You know, it's wow. Just like, it's white people feeling comfortable enough to actually dance, you know, in a poppy, non-waltzy manner.
Yeah, yeah.
No headbanging, no mosh pits, no nothing. Just people just enjoying the rhythm and swaying to the music. But then they started writing these weirder kind of novelty songs and almost like strange like southern balladry that they would get into. Time After Time sort of fits into that. It's got Peter Buck's jangly guitar riff, but it's a weird shifting beat under it. And then Michael Stipe's very, very strange lyrics, which he's only just in this period becoming like confident enough to really enunciate so that you can actually hear it. And it's just really strange. Like, does any of this make any sense? But I love listening to it because the chorus is very reminiscent of Cyndi Lauper's Time After Time chorus.
Like, really?
The song isn't just called Time After Time. The chorus or the phrase through it is time after time after time. Like, it's very, very similar to the Cyndi Lauper version. And I couldn't find the connection. Like, I couldn't find any quotes from Stipe or Cyndi Lauper talking about either song or where they came from. But nevertheless, it exists side by side. REM's coming out a couple of years later. And obviously, you know, not being released as a single and not conquering the world. But
yeah, he's probably when someone, you write a joke and then someone more famous writes a similar joke and you're just like, well, they get to have that. they're more famous and they put it out there. I can't do mine now.
It has to be just a borrowing of a phrase. Like, obviously, Cyndi Lauper doesn't own Time After Time.
Right.
But I don't know if it was REM like thumbing their nose at her, or if it was meant to be a compliment, or if they didn't think about it at all. But either way, it was always, because when I first bought that REM album when I was a teenager, I was looking at the songs on the back. I was like, they did it. I didn't know which direction it went in. You know, there was part of my brain that wanted to go, is that Cyndi Lauper song a cover of REM? Like, that was like, yeah. I wanted true, but then I listened to it and was like, well, it's obviously not true. And then you check the dates on things, just like, this one came out 2 years later. So yeah. I don't know what the story is, but it's always been a fascinating song, you know.
Interesting. So if I play a clip of that, do you want me to play the chorus?
I think you should play the chorus.
Okay. Yeah. Perfect.
Time after time after time. Time.
Watch the Middle of the Hour by the Water Tower Watch. Thanks, Mike. Thank you.
Okay.
So I wanted to, like, I was writing down the lyrics to REM's Time After Time because I thought it would be funny, like, if at the start of the episode I start reading this, like, Michael Stipe gibberish and just have you staring at me like, what in the fuck are you doing? Like,
oh, that's... All right. I'm excited to hear that. My deep cut, and here's one of those things where I'm always like, was this just like a song that's popular to me? But then I asked around, some people didn't know this song. And there's a reason why it wasn't like real mainstream, but a lot of people know it. But so do you know the song Heartbeats by The Knife?
I don't think so. You want to sing a few bars?
No, because she's got a very strong Swedish accent and you can hear it in the song. So here's why I love the song. So Heartbeat, The Knife is a Swedish electronic indie duo, and they're famous for their non-commercial philosophy and unwillingness to cooperate with the media or mainstream music scene. So as far as I can tell, no one even knows what they look like. When they're in concert, they're wearing these weird masks and it's very artistically done. And it's almost like more of like an art performance than, you know, they're trying to be rock stars. But the song it's always eluded me, the meaning of it, because it sounds like a poetry of a one night stand, like one night to be confused, one night to speed up truth. It just sounds like it's a lot about like one night and how great this one night was, but they were like in love. Where it got really popular is a cover by Jose Gonzalez, who's like this, he's Argentinian, but he's Swedish. Like he grew up in Sweden, I think. So he does this very, so they're, the Knife's version is very like synthesized and, you know, it sounds very old school new wave to me. He slows it down with just a guitar, just an acoustic guitar. And he's got very, very smooth vocals, and he made it like just this beautiful slow song.
One night of magic rose, the start of simple touch. One night to push and scream, and then relief. 10 days of perfect tunes, the colors red and blue. We had a promise made, we were in love. To call for hands up above, to lean on, wouldn't be good enough for me. To cover hands above, to lean on, wouldn't be good enough.
And my friend used it in her wedding, which always secretly made me laugh because I was like, I think this song's about a one-night stand. You're getting married.
That's what this marriage is. It's a one-night stand that lasts forever.
Lasted forever.
Every year is like an hour with you.
If you go onto YouTube and you put in Heartbeats by The Knife, and then you start looking at all the covers, you'll just find so many people who have covered the song because it's a simple, beautiful little song. And there's one by, and I'm gonna play clips of it. I don't know who they are, but it's called Royal Teeth. And it's a whole ensemble of people playing all these instruments. And the girl singing it has a beautiful, sweet little voice. And I love songs that people are so attracted to that everybody has to have a piece of it. It's that good. So that's my deep cut.
Excellent. I am going to check it out.
Heartbeats by The Knife. Okay, next week, it's Ben's choice again. It feels like it's been forever since we got to choose. So what are you going to bring us next week?
I'm kind of surprising myself because this is not a band whose music I particularly enjoy, and I kind of wish that that they could stay on the trash heap of the 90s. I wish that they were one of those bands that we could forget about. But I was reading about the story, specifically the story behind the song Hey Jealousy by the Gin Blossoms. And Diane, it kind of broke my heart. There's a lot, so much more to unpack with the Gin Blossoms than I ever would have imagined, particularly with the song Hey Jealousy.
I am with you. I wanted to not like them. And I think Jeremy might be screaming at us right now listening because I think he really likes them. But I think there's a lot more to this band than I initially thought too. And you know, the thing about bands that we think we hate, but we know all the lyrics to the song, like you can sing along with it. I didn't know what the term gin blossom meant. And maybe we can save that for next week. Yeah, once I found that out, I was like, oh, well, that's deep. That's interesting. Okay.
And to be fair to the Gin Blossoms, it's not that I'm probably wrong to feel about them the way that I do. I only feel that way because they were really big when I was at my most judgy teenage.
Me too. You know? Me too.
Like they were huge when I was 16 or 17. I was just like, just get it off my radio, man. Yeah.
I think that's the thing is they played it too much. The song was overplayed. Didn't they also do the I Found Out About You? Is that them? Yeah, that was overplayed. So yeah, I think that's what happens. These bands is the radio stations or can be at fault for ruining it.
For sure. Yeah. Don't overdo a good thing. Yeah, I really do think like if I discovered Gin Blossoms, you know, if they were like some smaller band that sold like 100,000 records in 1996 and I discovered them now, I'd be like, oh, right. You'd never hear the end of it. How did we miss these guys?
Yeah, we're jerks. We know that. We've established that we're judgy jerks.
Judgy jerkerson.
All right. Great episode. Till next week.
You ready? If you're lost, you can look and you will find me.
Time, let go time.
If you fall, I will catch you. I will be waiting.
No. Time after time. If you're lost, you can look and you will find me. Time after time. If you fall, I will catch you. I will be waiting. Time after time. Time after time. Time after time.
Charlie, that's okay.
She has no idea.
Time after time.
1, 2, 3. Rock the Cash Bar is produced by Diane Gallagher. Music by Chuck Savage and Eddie Hawkins. Special thank you to Jeremy Essig for 6 Degrees and to Sarah Wessling for the Guilty Pleasures vocals. Our website is rockthecashbarpodcast.com, and there you can find links to our Spotify playlist and to our Patreon. Thank you for tuning in, and we will see you next week.